Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm Amobi Okugo, host of Money Talks, a new podcast for my frugal athlete in partnership with Billion or Bust Media. Money Talks explores the world of business behind professional athletes. I speak with financial advisors, business managers, marketing and PR professionals who specialize in running the business of being a pro athlete. Tune into Money Talks on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. You can also find new episodes on BillionaireBustMedia.com and AFrugalAthlete.com. Again, BillionaireBustMedia.com or AFrugalAthlete.com.
Follow, like, subscribe. 2 Cents Podcast is going to go live in 5, 4. You ready? 3. Good day, folks. Welcome to the 2 Cents Podcast. I am your host of the 2 Cents Podcast, Jay Richardson, and I am excited to bring to you another fun-filled episode of what's going on around the sports world and what stories are important that we really have to take a look at, as we always do. We try to take a hard look at some stories that are shaking up the sports slash entertainment world to see where they intersect, and it's always important to see how the culture feels about it. As always, please follow, like, subscribe the 2 Cents Podcast. You can find that on IG at 2 Cents Pod or at 2 Cents Show, and myself, Jay Richardson 99 on Twitter. There's a lot of ways to find us. Just check us out and find us. Listen, got to get started, and I want to start with today's. It's not really today's top story, but it's a story that just every week I feel like we're discussing this, because every week it seems to pop up and it seems to be relevant. Antonio Brown last week decided to contact the young lady, the second accuser, and we'll get into that, but it resulted in the Patriots finally deciding to part ways after just 1 week of NFL football, which he performed very well, had a touchdown, a good handful of yards there for the Patriots in the opening game, and now is been released. We know this now. It's been a few days. I was very upset because I did not switch him off of my fantasy football team in time. I did not know, so I got 0 points for him on the same day where Mike Evans from Tampa Bay went crazy, and I had him on my bench. Very upset about that, but that ain't the story. Story is this. We're looking at... I don't want to say the demise of a career, because we all know the NFL and we all know how the NFL feels about super talented players. You will get a second and third and sometimes fourth chance, a la Josh Gordon. So anything is possible, but I have to say, I've never seen someone self-destruct so quickly and in such grand fashion, maybe ever in the history of professional sports. And this one is truly unique. You're looking at a guy right now, an Antonio Brown, who has just been released in a span of, I don't know, 3 weeks? No, in a span of 2 weeks, he's been released by two football teams, been accused of rape and sexual misconduct by two different people, and has cost himself well over $40 million in salary and bonuses in just 16 days, more or less. Unbelievable. On top of all of that, Nike just announced that they are dropping him from being under contract as a Nike player. He is no longer someone that is under contract with him, so look for him to wear new cleats if he ever comes back. But I don't know that he'll be coming back anytime soon. He just re-enrolled in Central Michigan, and he's going to take some courses there and get his mind right. But how did we get to this? We got to this for a handful of reasons. Because you got to go through the timeline, right? Had some issues with the Pittsburgh Steelers in the locker room 2 years ago, going on Facebook Live during one of head coach Mike Tomlin's speeches. He was asked to put his cell phone down, did not. Not only did he not put it down, he recorded the speech and recorded himself on Facebook Live. And, you know, we live, baby. And really, really drew the ire of the coach, Ben Roethlisberger, and the team. Exchanged a series of tweets back and forth with Roethlisberger, and Roethlisberger went on a radio show, bashed him, basically. And they were not seeing eye to eye. He asked for a trade. At that time, he wanted to be traded to the Patriots. The Pittsburgh Steelers vetoed that deal, kept him on one more season. The following season, he was then traded to the Oakland Raiders. Oakland Raiders wanted to sign him to a new deal, give him like $30 million in guarantees and a whole bunch of other monies that he never collected on, because the moment he touched feet down in Oakland, he began to try to sabotage the deal himself, starting with the cryotherapy issue with his feet. When that didn't work, he decided to complain about the helmet, tried to sue the league about his helmet. When that didn't work, he just stopped showing up to practices, wouldn't acquiesce to all of the GMs and coaches' requests to just show up and go to work, man, and we'll get you your money and we'll get this thing going and you'll be a Raider. Didn't do it, so he was fined in excess of $270,000 in fines, and finally released a Twitter promo video to promote the issues he'd been having with Gruden, and he taped Gruden's conversation and things got strange. We've discussed all of this stuff. Finally, the Raiders said, can't do it, man, we're done with you. They release him, to which he responded with a video of him again on Twitter getting the news about the release and jumping for joy, because apparently it seemed like he had this master plan which had finally come to fruition, where he would end up ultimately where he wanted to be all along, which was the New England Patriots, who picked him up within about 2 hours of his release, which I called, by the way. And that was that. So now AB's going to be a Patriot. We all assume he'll be a Patriot all season long. Signed a deal with, $9 million plus in guarantees, and felt really good, was all excited, and goes out there week one, plays very well for the Patriots. Him and Tom Brady are shooting videos together, working out and hanging out, and he's at the TB12 facility out there in Boston, and they're loving life. And then come the sexual misconduct allegations and rape allegations. A former trainer of his decides to come out, a week before her wedding and talk about, some encounters that she had with him from 2 years ago, four specific encounters where she flew to him and apparently they were physical, and apparently she didn't like how things went for a number of different reasons I won't even get into, because it doesn't matter. The point is, he was accused of sexual misconduct and rape, and then there was a second accuser that came out and accused him of sexual misconduct, and this one was far stranger. Apparently she was there to do a painting at his home or something like that, and he came downstairs in the nude. Listen, in full disclosure, I'm kind of a nudist myself. When I'm at home, I'm not big on clothes, but I assume if I had a house guest who is not a friend or someone that's expecting that, I'd probably at least throw a towel on. I don't know. Apparently he had a washcloth, not a towel. He's not the biggest guy. He's, 5'10", 5'11", so maybe he doesn't need a whole towel to cover himself. I don't know. The point is, she took that the wrong way, or maybe he meant for it to be taken the wrong way. I don't know. I wasn't there. I just know that this led to a second sexual misconduct allegation. And she felt, after a year or so, now's the time to let everyone know that he walks around strangers in towels. This was not a good look, and he was asked specifically, not just by his legal team, but also by the New England Patriots, please do not try to contact this accuser. Just leave it alone. The league will vet this. They will send their investigators, and they will get to the bottom of it, and we'll find out, how serious this is. By the way, none of these accusations or charges that were filed are criminal charges. They're all civil. So the first one is a civil matter altogether. She filed a civil suit for something like $80,000. Again, interesting. And the second accuser didn't file any charges. They just want you to know that he's gross. So all this happens, and he makes the mistake of going full on AB and sending her messages and messages. And of course, she keeps the messages and screenshots them and releases them to the public, where he's calling her broke and lame and stupid and yada yada, just childish behavior yet again by an adult male in a position to make a lot of money, which he will now not make, because not only did the New England Patriots release him, they also decided not to pay him his $9 million that was supposed to be quote unquote in guarantees, which people learn all the time about the NFL. It's not like baseball or basketball. Even when it says guaranteed money, it ain't really guaranteed money. They're gonna make you get it. They're gonna make you earn it. They're gonna make you fight for it. And if you mess up before it's in your hands, it might never be in your hands. And that's something, kids at home, you gotta know right away. So with his career in jeopardy, with him being released from a second team, with his agent Drew Rosenhaus saying he is healthy and ready to play for the next team that wants to step up to the plate, AB decides to go back to college. AB tweets out before that that I am done with this league. I'm done with football. He talks about his lack of trust in the Patriots ownership and how, you know, he thought they had an agreement, and it's really messed up how teams can just decide not to pay. I'm sure the team would agree it's really messed up how players can decide not to show up to work and decide, you know, they don't want to listen, you know, to do what the team asks them to do. So both sides have a legitimate gripe. As a former player, I usually side with the players because I understand the business aspect of it and what the players are risking versus what the team is risking. And they're two very different risks. However, in this instance, I got to say, AB, man, you blew it, bro. You absolutely blew it. Wait till you get the bag before you self-destruct. If you want to go nuts and go full on AB, get your $9 million first and then go full on AB. Or hell, if you really, it was about the money, you should have stayed with the Raiders and got your full 30 and just played out the season and let it be, like the Beatles say, just let it be. But he couldn't because he's AB and he has to be a nut, and that's the end of that story, I'm sure. And looking forward, there have been a lot of speculation. Will he play again? Will he ever be in the NFL again? And, you know, you've heard a lot of big-time, network correspondents and analysts and show hosts like Stephen A. Smith and others say they don't think he'll ever play in the NFL again. My personal opinion, will AB play in the NFL again? I say absolutely. Trust me, this is a very forgiving league, especially when you're super talented and you're talking about a Hall of Fame wide receiver who's in his physical prime still. And according to all reports, when he was in the Oakland Raiders uniform in practice, he was destroying people in practice. When he was last seen playing football for the New England Patriots, he was destroying people and scoring touchdowns on back shoulder fades and still beating guys one-on-one against separation. So let's not act like this dude can't go on the field right now and change your team's outlook offensively immediately. He can do that, and I believe before 2019 ends, he will have done that for some team that'll step up. If I had to take a stab on what team it's going to be that'll take a chance on AB, you got to think of what owner out there has the kind of cachet where he can take this kind of shot and lose, you know, bet on AB, and if he does lose, can handle it, and if he does win big, will look like a genius, and also has the cap space, and also, by the way, doesn't need much cap space now because he's officially just a guy looking for a job, but also looks at his core team and goes, man, we could really use a threat like that. And a couple teams come to mind, but one specific owner, which is the one that I had in mind the first time he was released from the Oakland Raiders, is Jerry Jones. Think about Jerry Jones's history with big-time diva wide receivers, you know, i.e. Michael Irving and or Terrell Owens, and how he was able to handle these guys and get them in there and get them to be productive members of the Dallas Cowboys community. I think Jerry Jones might make a move at some point. Let's say injuries pile up in their receiving core. You know, let's say Amari Cooper could use some help. Don't be shocked if you see I swear it could happen. And don't be shocked if you see AB at some point with that big old star on his helmet and adding serious value to a team that would love to make a huge push to be in the Super Bowl this year. So that's my guess, prediction, or, you know, if I had to take a shot in the dark at it, I wouldn't put that past anyone. Now, we got to move on to what I saw this weekend. Yeah, there were tons of great NFL games, a lot of interesting things to discuss. One thing we saw on Monday Night Football, which I never want to see again on Monday Night Football, is the Washington Redskins. They better not ever be on a Monday Night game again. They are done with Monday Nights. I don't care what anybody says. Their last seven outings have been just awful, pathetic. I don't know how, you know, ESPN keeps putting them on Monday Night Football. And the other night was no exception. You know, you had the Redskins playing against that Chicago Bears defense and that average quarterback, Mitchell Trubisky, who, by the way, Mitch Trubisky's looking like he is headed for Bustville if he doesn't figure out how to throw a football more than 14 yards and in a hurry. Thankfully, he has that defense to lean on, and that's why they ended up beating the Washington Redskins handily. They absolutely dominated the Redskins defensively, and, you know, Mitch and the boys on offense did just enough to make it look like it was a much more dominating game than it actually was. But moving forward, they still have some questions to be answered about Mitchell Trubisky. But my My concerns were on the other side of the field, and that's with the Washington Redskins and Case Keenum and how he came out there and had five turnovers, looked absolutely abysmal, and people started screaming for my man from The Ohio State University, Dwayne Haskins, to be put on that field. Everyone's trying to figure out why they didn't play Dwayne Haskins. Jay Gruden, whose time is almost up in D.C. in our nation's capital, discussed the idea that he doesn't believe Dwayne Haskins is ready. He's said it countless times. He doesn't think he's ready to go yet. Here's what I'll say about this, because this is an interesting situation, and you see so often rookies, rookie quarterbacks who were drafted in the first round, they're handled, all of them, differently. Some are looked at as, you know, the messiah and the savior of the football team, and they need to go out there right now and make a difference, i.e. Andrew Luck, right? They put him out there, you know, day one, as soon as they could, and to his credit, played really well. RG3 had an amazing rookie year. You saw Lamar Jackson get a chance to get out there his rookie year last year and make a difference. And then, obviously, Pat Mahomes was treated differently. He sat and watched Alex Smith and had a chance to just kind of wait and get a feel for what he needed to do, and he got the chance to learn. And then the next year, he took the league by storm and became the MVP of the NFL, the reigning MVP as of right now. So there's a lot of different ways to handle it. I'm very, very glad, as inept as Jay Gruden is as a head coach and shouldn't have had that job, I'm very glad that he did not put Dwayne Haskins on the field. Why? Tell me, what's to gain by putting a rookie out in the middle of a football game where you are getting absolutely demolished, you have zero momentum, and you have injuries on both sides of the ball, and on top of that, you're going against Khalil Mack, former defensive league MVP and the best defense in the NFL. Why on earth would you subject a rookie to that kind of to me, punishment? For what? What did he do to deserve that? He doesn't need to be out there. No. Case Keenum, take your lumps, and hopefully you crawl out of that game with a little bit of pride left, which, I mean, I think he was stripped of all of it. No, I'm glad they didn't. Why? He's going to go out there. He's going to get himself, goodness, picked apart and beat up and hopefully not hurt, and all for what? You know, was the goal to maybe he'll catch fire and he'll bring some juice to the offense? He's not a mobile guy, so you don't want him running from number 52 from the Bears all day long. And on top of that, the idea that if he goes out there and gets destroyed, both physically and mentally with the game plan, you have an issue where you really, really, really hurt a young player's confidence. And young players' psyche, especially at the quarterback position, very, very fragile. Very, very fragile. You do not want to put him out there and give him a chance to not look his best. Not to mention, you haven't built a game plan around him. You're going to put him in Case Keenum's offense. His offense is going to look a little bit different. Whenever they decide to go with Dwayne Haskins, they will need a full week's worth of practice. They'll need to implement a bunch of new wrinkles that make him comfortable, whether that be more shotgun, whether that be a handful of RPOs, whether that be quick passes, whether that be different routes and different blocking schemes. You're going to want to make this kid comfortable, and you're going to want to put him in an offense that makes sense for a rookie quarterback. Yes, he has an elite skill set. Yes, he has a cannon for an arm, but he hasn't been in the NFL yet. He doesn't know what he's doing yet, and that's okay. A lot of rookies don't, but you don't throw them in there with someone else's offense that's been tailored for them. And it'd be like me going outside the house and wearing, you know, our producer Chris's clothes. It's not going to fit me. That's not – those clothes weren't for me. As fly as he is, those clothes are not for me. I want to go out in my clothes. And if you're going to get one crack at this thing, you want to go out and have the offense prepared for you. So, good thing they didn't play Dwayne Haskins. Will they play him in the future? Absolutely. How quickly will it come? I don't know. It kind of depends on Jay Gruden's job. If Jay Gruden is fired – which many believe he will not survive this season. If that is indeed the case, then yes, you're going to see a situation where Jay Gruden leaves and the new head coach is going to come in, and with the new head coach comes a new everything. You're going to see a new offensive staff probably, and then you're going to see them want to get the new guy ready to go, and you'll probably see Haskins out there before the year's over with. That's what I believe. Or another thing will happen. Jay Gruden will be so threatened to lose his job that he'll think, I got to make a huge change. The pressure to play Haskins will be just overwhelming, and he'll just make the move. I hope he doesn't do it mid-game. I hope he waits till the week begins to prepare this kid for his first outing as a starter in the NFL. He deserves that much. Every rookie does at quarterback. Next thing we've got to discuss is the G-men, right? New York Giants go out there for the first time in over a decade and they bench Eli Manning, and there's a new quarterback at the helm, and it is rookie, speaking of rookie quarterbacks, it is the rookie that was taken in front of Dwayne Haskins, the rookie that everyone made, you know, a huge, huge, myself included, made it seem like the Giants made the mistake of the century taking Daniel Jones over Dwayne Haskins. We all said it. I said it. I thought it was a horrible, horrible decision. I still stand by that only because I think Dwayne would have done a fantastic job in the Giants offense with Saquon. However, GM David Gettleman, I have to give you your credit because Daniel Jones, at least for this one game, looked like the real deal. Against Tampa Bay Buccaneers, Daniel Jones threw 36 passes. He completed 23 of them for 336 yards and 4 touchdowns. That is a big-time game from a rookie. It's not so much the stats that'll impress you when you watch the film. It's how comfortable he looked. It's how decisive he looked, where he wanted to go with the football. And it's his command of the huddle and how much energy he seemed to give the players around him. Whenever you see a quarterback change and you see every other position group elevate their game, that tells me a couple of things. One, it tells me they've believed he should have been the guy all along. Whenever the other positions are, whether it be the receivers or the running backs or the offensive line, whenever they're all excited and they're juiced up for this new quarterback, that to me tells me they know something we didn't know all along, which is in practice, this kid was slinging it and they wanted to see him out there. It tells me Eli was throwing ducks, pigeons, whatever you want to call them, and this kid was throwing darts, and that's who they wanted to see. And, yeah, the players are usually right because they play with this guy every day. And it turns out he lit it up, and he looked confident. I liked his post-game interview when they tried to, you know, put him on the spot about how many people were running their mouth about him, even Baker Mayfield from the Browns, who we'll get to when they discussed all of these guys and just the public sentiment that he shouldn't have been there. And all he could say was, listen, happy we played well and we're on to the next week, and he handled it like a classy young quarterback should. I'm liking this guy more and more. He's from Duke, so you know he's going to be a cerebral guy, at least you'd assume that, and he looked like he was able to process things at NFL speed between the ears, and he was able to translate that into his right arm, which he let go, and he was on the money. I mean, he was throwing some darts, and he made some impressive runs. He's more athletic than I thought he was. Had a big 18, 20-yard run there on the third down for a touchdown that impressed me. He was quoted as going into the huddle before that drive and saying, "Less effing score." And the whole offensive line looked at him like, who is this guy? Because they've never heard Eli talk that way, apparently. I like that aggression. Tells me he's got a little alpha male in him. Tells me that he wants to win. Tells me that he's hungry for it. And he's excited to be a starter. This is good. This is very good for the New York Giants. This could change the way we look at the NFC East, especially because Carson Wentz and the Philadelphia Eagles looked very, very, very bad. Got a quick blurb about them before we're out of here later on. But yes, Daniel Jones looked for at least one afternoon like the real deal. We will see if he can keep it going. Who hasn't seemed to be able to keep it going and who is, I don't know, just seems like they just were never going to be the team that everyone wanted them to be in the offseason is the Cleveland Browns. It seems like the Browns are already sinking before they even get going. We all know the offseason the Browns had. We all know the big name additions, you know, from defensive additions to obviously the signing of Odell Beckham Jr. and all the hype that brings. With everything going on, everyone crowned them in the offseason. I mean, people were going, man, these guys look like they have a playoff team already assembled on paper, possibly a Super Bowl team on paper. That's what some delirious folks from Cleveland were saying. Here's the problem, as we heard from coaches in the past, the game ain't played on paper. It's played on that grassy, patch called a football field, and you got to actually prove it. And so far, the Cleveland Browns are 1-2, and they just don't look right. Yes, a lot of injuries. Offensive line's been riddled with injuries. Their secondary isn't even their secondary. They look bad, but man, it's how they're not executing, I guess, is the issue, and how it seems like Baker Mayfield has regressed. I want you guys to think back to back in the summer when I said, hey, Baker Mayfield, it's easy to come out. Not easy, but it's not too difficult to come out and catch the league by storm if you're talented. RG3 did it. Came out as a rookie, and no one was prepared for him. No one had any film on him. They didn't understand his skill set, and people got torched by him, his arm and the legs. Baker Mayfield comes out. No one knew his skill set, and he was able to be very effective as a rookie. Looked really, really good. Caught some people and some teams by surprise. Problem is, once you're on film for so long, you start to put who you are on that film. And everyone, no matter who you are, has tendencies. Everyone, no matter who you are, has weaknesses. And those will get picked apart the more games you put on film. And it seems like the learning curve has caught up and the league has caught up to what Baker Mayfield is good at and what he's bad at. And defenses are stopping him. And he is struggling. And that is where the Browns are right now. You're looking at a team that has, you know, the NFL's longest playoff drought. It's just, are they going to be able to make the playoffs this year? At 1-2, their chances are not very good. And as you look at their schedule and how it shakes out, there's a lot of tough games for the Cleveland Browns, and I don't think anyone's expecting them to do it. And the biggest reason to me, if you had to ask me, is head coach Freddie Kitchens. I don't know how this guy got the job. I get that he was the interim head coach, and you know they played pretty well for a handful of games, but for some reason, he did not prepare himself in the offseason, and there were a lot of serious critical coaching errors that he made in that game. And after, you know, to his credit, he took credit for these coaching errors. But the problem is, dude, you got to know the situation and know what you need to do. And some of these decisions he was making in play calling was just god-awful, and he's got to know that. But how did he get the job? Why did he get hired over any other coach who plenty of qualified guys out there, and they went with this Freddie Kitchens guy, and now they're stuck with him. Will he finish the year as the head coach? I don't know. That is a great question. I'm going to say I don't know that Kitchens finishes this year as the head coach, but more so than that, he's got to learn how to call an offense if that's what he wants to do, because it was just bad. And Mayfield, you know, didn't seem like it was absolutely awful. You know, 13 of 18 passing for 114 yards and a touchdown. It was the way the offense looked and some of the play calls. And even Baker said, hey, I'm going to execute what's called. I didn't execute. That is kind of a passive-aggressive way of saying I did not like the call at all, but I'm going to take credit as the starting, you know, quarterback for not executing the play that was called, even though I do not like the play calling. And all of these kind of comments that we're reading about the Browns are slowly becoming an indictment on Freddie Kitchens. So that's something that he needs to get figured out, and that's something that moving forward, the Cleveland Browns have to decide what direction they want to go with. Now, there's one last thing before we get out of here that I got to bring up, because it was just funny. It was just a funny thing that happened, and I loved the way this particular athlete handled it. So, if you guys recall, a week ago, there was a very big game with the Eagles, and I believe it was the Eagles and the Lions, and what happened was at some point in that game, there was a catch that was dropped by Philly wide receiver Nelson Agholor, right? He drops this big, big-time catch in a critical situation that could have won the game. They did not win the game, and, you know, whatever. Everyone's going to blame someone. A lot of people definitely blame Nelson Agholor for not catching that ball. Guys drop passes all the time, you know. People drop passes every day, B. What you gonna do? But a Philadelphia man, a handful of days later, was saving children from a burning building. He's no normal man. His name is Hakeem Laws, and he's a former firefighter in Philadelphia. He's doing an interview now after being dubbed a hero for catching kids jumping out of a burning building. That's big time stuff, right? During the interview, they ask him about catching these kids and saving lives. And this is just speaks so much to the Philadelphia sports culture and to their fan base and how serious they are about their sports. The man had an opportunity to talk about the children or the building or his history as a firefighter or everything that, you know, how happy he was that the lives were saved. Yeah. All that's whatever to him. All he cared about was throwing shots. Because what the man said was, yeah, I actually caught the kids and did my job. Unlike Agholor, alluding to Nelson Agholor dropping the pass. And that was the pettiest sports fan comment I've ever heard in my entire life, maybe just because of the circumstances surrounding why this man's on camera, and he chose that moment to take a shot at a hometown guy, one of the guys from their team who did not get it done. This is Philadelphia fandom. They are vicious, they are brutal, and I love it. So hats off to you, Hakeem Laws. Had to give him a quick shout out. Former firefighter, saved about 3 or 4 lives, but still took the time to throw that shade. I love it, and I love you guys. So that has been your two cents for this week. I want to thank you guys for tuning in. As always, like, subscribe, spread the word, and until next time.